Welcome to Space News from the Electric Universe, brought to you by the Thunderbolts Project at thunderbolts.info. The foundations of the electric universe theory lie in historic experimental science. The earliest electrical pioneers proved decades ahead of their time. From Norwegian experimentalist Christian Birkeland, who correctly hypothesized that charged particles from the sun produce the earthly auroras, to chemist and physicist Irving Langmuir, who coined the term plasma for, quote, ionized gases, and who invented the diagnostic method for electrostatic probes to measure both temperature and density, to Nobel Prize winner Hannes Alfvén, the father of plasma cosmology, whose experimental research led him to caution astrophysicists against modeling space plasmas while effectively ignoring electric currents. Today, the hands-on experimental approach to the electric universe theory continues. The rapidly growing electrical geology community includes many members who have conducted simple experiments, testing the role that powerful lightning and other forms of electrical discharge may have played in shaping rocky bodies throughout the solar system. In this episode, we introduce a new contributor to this community. Jacob Gable is an experimentalist who has focused on crater formation and other geological effects produced by electrical discharge in a vacuum chamber. In this introduction, we ask Jacob to explain some of the most intriguing results he has captured to date. The link to Jacob's YouTube channel may be found in the description box of this video.
I've always been very interested in outer space. Looking out into other worlds is always interesting. Sci-fi, anywhere I can get it. I found myself watching the Discovery Channel, History Channel, all throughout my life, you know, being very interested in any subject matter pertaining to outer space, deep space, black holes, all the stuff. I watched a lot of YouTube entertaining all sorts of different ideas. I saw several Thunderbolts videos during this escapade of looking, you know, wanting to know more about the universe. I began watching more and more of the Thunderbolts videos, I guess specifically Space News. I found myself actually looking for these videos now. I was introduced to Billy Yelverton's work, which was a huge influence for me. Started watching his videos and saw him producing all these features that we can see here on Earth and in other places in the solar system. And that was a big eye-opener for me. I think a big turning point was when I saw Getting Serious About Ceres that was done by Steve Smith. And I felt that this hypothesis was likely very, very testable. I felt that way because I saw Ceres and I felt that it actually had been subject to really intense electrical discharge, and I felt like I could see it in my mind. I saw the surface and the blasting of the craters, and it was like being unplugged from the Matrix. It was pretty intense. And from then, I've always pursued looking at the electric universe idea because it's really mind-blowing, and I truly like the fascination about that and being able to possibly test it. I was lucky enough to come across plasma sculpture. In plasma sculpture, you're basically mixing gases at different pressures and subjecting them to high voltages and getting different colorful effects, if you will. And I felt this was a good way to help me express my interest in the electric universe to people as opposed to just telling them. This experiment was inspired by a Space News episode about Martian dust devils that would form. It was hypothesized by Wall Thornhill that these dust storms that form on Mars originate as a result of the tenuous atmosphere of Mars and it being a low pressure and it causing not an arc discharge but a glow discharge, if you will, or a diffuse discharge. This results in the formation of dust devils that will eventually cover the whole planet in a large dust storm. So I thought if I put sand inside of my vacuum chamber and removed most of the air and created this low pressure environment and also applied a voltage, I might be able to produce some of these dust devils. I got the the cratering effects, and I was I guess I was surprised, and I shouldn't have been, because this is what I had basically been waiting for all along, and what Thunderbolts advocates had been saying. So it was really, really exciting when I first saw the cratering. In this video, you can see a large web of discharges or filaments that are forming in the sand, and it's really interesting to see kind of the arc discharge in the sand and the glow discharge at the surface in the low pressure gas. It makes you wonder about lightning on our own Earth, cometary phenomena, cryovolcanic jets and plumes on moons. You know, what are all these electrical effects having in the ground, and where are they originating from? So it's really interesting to see that. You can also see the effects of pressure changes as the pressure increases in the chamber. The large web of thin filaments will eventually form one arc discharge that can be seen in the sand, and eventually a crater forms that has straight line edges. Here can be seen the effects of H2O inside of the chamber. When the water is subject to lower pressures, it can begin to vaporize because the atmospheric pressure inside the chamber will be relatively the same, causing the water to boil. When this happens, the outgassing or boiling of the water will bring the lightest materials of the silica to the surface and can often cover the whole entire surface of the silica in the chamber. When a discharge is forming, the silica and the fine materials will cover the edges of the crater and can leave a soft edge crater or a fluffy crater. We see some of these craters in our solar system that seem to be covered in fine particles or materials, and one could possibly hypothesize that these rocky bodies once had water on them that was liquid, and these bodies were subject to rapid decreases in pressure, which caused the water to boil and bring these lighter materials to the surface. And then it would also be noted that there was an electric discharge present that was causing the craters to form. Another interesting thing about the outgassing is that this outgassing itself can often produce craters and a cratered surface without an electric discharge. This is pretty interesting because when looking at craters in our solar system, we are normally only left with impact cratering or volcanism to explain the craters we see. Electric discharge isn't ever used, but also we never hear much about an outgassing crater. So I think that it's interesting that even in a non-electric universe perspective, we're still not getting the full picture of what we possibly could be, because there's these possible outgassing craters. And also in this video, you can see that when the discharge is extinguished suddenly, there will be a large surface eruption where the fine materials at the surface will sort of shoot up or bounce up off of the surface. And I guess that one's still pretty much open for discussion as to how that happens. Many different things, I guess, could be possible. So, pretty interesting. This video shows, again, some of the effects of H2O. It's different from the previous video in that the surface wasn't covered in fine materials, and instead the outgassing formed specific channels where it seemed that the discharge prefers to use these channels, likely because there's more gas there and less of the silica blocking the path for the electrical current. And I left the vacuum running to continue to pull out the vapor and the outgassing while the discharge was going. And you can see in part 4 of the video that the craters begin to show a more sharper, defined edges. And, you know, this is pretty interesting because I think we can use these demonstrations as possible hypothesis for how craters are forming in our solar system bodies. You can also see some interesting jets and even some bell-shaped plasmas coming out of the surface in the final moments when most of the vapor is being removed and the vacuum is basically becoming a low-pressure system. This demonstration also shows that there can be several craters formed that are actually a bit larger than what is capable with a dry experiment. I've added a little more H2O to the chamber than I was using in previous experiments. You can really be seeing the effects of H2O outgassing influencing the shape of the crater throughout the video. There are times when both the discharge and the outgassing are really influencing the shape. It seems that the rim crater begins forming when a more direct connection is being made in the electrical circuit. At this part of the video, you can see kind of the discharge forming the rimmed crater, and the boiling is still affecting the larger crater. And of course, the ending segments of the video, when the discharge is actually removed, the images are very familiar with rocky bodies in our solar system. It's very easily comparable. After doing some of these experiments, it's really affected the way I now see images of moons and rocky bodies. Just typing into Google moons or craters and rimmed craters, polygonal craters, it's almost haunting to have a large rimmed crater at the base of a wine bottle inside of my kitchen that looks almost identical to something that I've seen right on my computer screen that is supposed to be, far away from me. It's really helped me see things, the universe, in an actual attainable way where I'm not just sitting down and looking at a book and wondering why Neptune is so blue. I can now actually experiment with these things. I could start to see that I did not actually have to go to outer space in order to see or experience outer space. I could actually bring these worlds right to me. This has really started to become a realization, as opposed to just an idea.